Today we're talking about Hong Kong, China's Puerto Rico. Alright, I know it's part of America, but they don't vote for president. I think they pay federal taxes. It's complicated. So let's get started from the beginning of Hong Kong's history. Much like most of the angriest regions in the world today, Hong Kong was created by a British guy with a Sharpie and a map. After the Opium War, Hong Kong was given to the British to be the official port for them to dump more opium in China than a big pharma company in the Midwest. This ownership was continued when the ailing Qing Dynasty leased the new territories to Britain for 99 years, starting July 1, 1898. Now back in 1898, that 99-year lease was assumed to be a substitute for forever, because the British Empire will never die, and China? Yeah, okay. This brings us to 1982, when the writing was on the wall that, well, that forever lease was due to expire in 1997, and the sun had long set on the British Empire.
The British Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, exchanged the final documents in December with the Chinese Prime Minister, Zhao Ziyang. Britain acknowledges that when the lease runs out in 1997 on most of the territory, the whole of Hong Kong will revert to China.
Okay, so they were part of China then. Well, not really, because Great Britain negotiated a one-country, two-systems agreement with China. First thing you'll notice in this agreement is, man, Great Britain still doesn't have the best foresight when it comes to making agreement deadlines. So it only lasts 50 years until 2047. When sorry Hong Kong, but it looks like it's one country, one system now. Look forward to that episode in 28 years. For the meantime, what does this agreement that governs Hong Kong's relationship with China say? Well, it's laid out in Hong Kong's constitution, also known as the Basic Law, and it comes with this fancy cover page. Believe me though, there is nothing basic about this 156-page founding document. The key points to this law are Article 1, Hong Kong is an inalienable part of the People's Republic of China. They even stuck the word inalienable in there just in case you weren't sure how much a part of China Hong Kong is. It then says that the National People's Congress authorizes the Hong Kong people to exercise a high degree of autonomy and enjoy executive, legislative, and independent judicial power. So, okay, you're definitely part of China in every way except for all three branches of your government. Hong Kong residents shall have freedom of speech, of the press and of publication, freedom of association, of assembly, of procession, and of demonstration, bet they regret that last one, and the right of freedom to form and join trade unions and to strike. So, okay, pretty independent then. I mean, it sounds like everything China is infamous for is banned in Hong Kong. So what's the problem?
Organizers say nearly 2 million marching across the city to voice their anger at their Beijing-backed leader, Carrie Lam, and her controversial bill that would allow suspected criminals to be extradited from Hong Kong to mainland China. People fear Beijing would use this to target its critics like politicians, dissidents, and journalists.
Whoa. Now that clip might sound straightforward, but whew, if you're like me, that report just inspired a lot more questions than answers. I mean, before we talk about this controversial law, you kinda glossed over a pretty big detail.
Voice their anger at their Beijing-backed leader, Carrie Lam.
Beijing-backed leader winning in a Hong Kong election? I mean, crazier things have happened. 2016! But this is raising more red flags than a Soviet invasion. So before we get into the controversial law, let's talk about this leader, because Hong Kong's chief executive, Carrie Lam, is quite the controversial character. Also, chief executive is your leader's title? We get it, Hong Kong, you're capitalist. Don't need to rub our noses in it. Well, the first thing you immediately notice when you look into Hong Kong is it's not as democratic as one would imagine based on the news coverage they're getting. Their constitution says the method for selecting the chief executive shall be specified in the light of the actual situation in Hong Kong, in accordance with the principle of gradual and orderly progress. The ultimate aim is universal suffrage upon nomination by a broadly representative nominating committee in accordance with democratic procedures. Now, let me translate that from English to American. Oh, the goal is one person, one vote for our leaders. But these things take time. I mean, we were a colony up until 1997. Cut us some slack. Currently, the chief executive is chosen by a committee of 1,200 people who are said to represent the city. Now, this is the reason people are protesting.
The extradition bill's been suspended. What's this all about now? Is it all about the territory's leader, Carrie Lam, having to resign?
Well, the protesters, of course, they want Carrie Lam to resign because after all these big protests, she didn't really apologize and she even thanked the probation camp for supporting her. And so that's why people are very angry.
Yeah, thanking the probation camp at the height of anti-Chinese protests, unless there's a huge pro-Chinese constituency existing in the shadows of Hong Kong that I'm not aware of. Oh, something weird is going on here. I mean, look at their legislative branch, too. 60% of your representatives are pro-Beijing, while 35% are pro-democracy. Well, the people have voted, and turns out they don't like it. For an autonomous region that does not want to join China, your government certainly doesn't show it. So how did we get to an anti-Chinese quasi-democracy where two-thirds of the branches of government are pro-China? The judiciary is the third branch, and legally speaking, they're independent. Well, first, the executive branch. As Brookings points out, the electorate was not the 7.3 million residents of Hong Kong, but rather a 1,194-person election committee. Lam was clearly Beijing's preferred choice, and the fact that she secured 777 votes illustrated the fact that the pro-Beijing camp, which holds a majority of the seats in the election committee, unified around her. That's pretty simple. Of the 1,200 people to vote for president, more than half are pro-China. So how did the legislature go so far pro-China? Well, this report came from the last legislative election in 2016.
The problem here is they don't want the legislative council to be held by the pro-Beijing groups, which is the majority right now as it stands. But as I mentioned, if the pro-democracy camp reaches the one-third amount of seats, they have a right and they have more of a voice to have a say on pro-Beijing plans.
You heard that report right. In a democracy, the pro-democracy party's goal was to get just a third of the seats so that they could finally veto legislation. As we said at the top, they did get 35% of the vote, so yay, now they have the power to slow everything down. So how did Beijing get so many seats? Well, only half of the seats in the legislature are filled by popular elections. Most of the other half of the seats are filled by industry and business groups. And China's booming economy means Beijing enjoys greater leverage over the Hong Kong economy, now more than it did even a decade ago, especially in finance. Oh man, that sucks. Now you're probably getting a bit more of a feel why people in Hong Kong are so angry right now. Beijing's supported president can propose legislation that their majority in Congress can pass, and woohoo, we're totally independent. Furthermore, the system is incapable of internal reforms because, while their constitution specifically says the end goal is universal suffrage, well, neither the pro-Beijing president nor the pro-Beijing legislature wants that to happen. Luckily for Hong Kongers, their constitution is very clear about their rights, and their judicial branch is internationally acknowledged as impartial. Last year, Hong Kong's ranking for judicial independence in the World Economic Forum's Global Competitiveness Index, wow, that's a mouthful, slipped to 13th from 8th the year before. Okay, that might sound bad because it's slipping, but that means they're the 13th most impartial court system in the world, placing them between Sweden and Israel. Furthermore, America is 25th, so they're twice as good as us. This does mean that any law short of being unconstitutional based on Hong Kong's constitutional freedoms of speech, assembly, press, and all those important rights we went over earlier in the episode can be passed by China in Hong Kong. So that's why people in Hong Kong are continuing to protest. There's essentially a pipeline for Beijing to pass laws in Hong Kong, and the main thing they can do is not votes, but rather hit the streets. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this episode. If you did, click on this floating logo to the right of my head to subscribe to my channel, ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.